Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sharice Johnson, and my project is a really long title, so I'm not going to read it. But these five images that I have on the opening slide, I thought best represented the photographers that I'm talking about in this project. And they are Zanele Muholi, Maïmouna Guerresi, Aïda Muluneh, Atong Atem, Thandiwe Muriu. And they are all from Africa or live there. And pretty much what I have is my project was to compare their works to earlier African male photographers, mainly in the late 19th and early 20th century. And these are the two ones that I selected to use for the bulk of my research, just because they represent a time when before, both prior to colonization and after, with Solomon Allange, who also his career spanned from the 1940s all the way to 1994, just before he died in 95. So the theory of cultural identity is what I use to define my or foreground my research. And I used the questions of cultural identity by Stuart Hall and Paul DeGay. I also pulled extensively from Michelle M. Wright's Becoming Black, Creating Identity in the African Diaspora, and the African Diaspora, African Origins, and the New World Identities. And I used it to pretty much, the cultural identity is a formation of who you are, all of the communities that you belong to, all different sides of your personality, and sometimes they clash. And this is what you find, especially in the African community. And the image that I have on the left is by Maïmouna Guerresi. She uses her images to be more inclusive in her religion. She's a practicing Sufism, excuse me. And she was born in Italy, but she immigrated to Senegal, where she also splits her time between Senegal and Italy. She's not full-time there, but she draws from her community, both in Senegal and Italy, and she uses her religion to show that both genders can participate in religion and spirituality, which you don't find in all Islamic sects. And then on the right, I have Zanele Muholi. Their work is focusing on the LGBTQIA+ community, particularly in South Africa, where even though it's the most progressive of all the African nations when it comes to the rights of this community, there's still a lot of violence and attacks, and sometimes it results in death, unfortunately. And then I also have Atong Atem. And what I'm doing here is just comparing J.A. Green's earlier work that was in 1906, and to her work, which is of a bridal image. She took it from her own family album, and pretty much she recreated it with herself as the bride. And the image on the left is a bride as well, but it was repurposed without the model's consent and turned into a postcard to sell to foreigners. And that's what the gist of my research is about, like how Africans were sort of were misrepresented, and their practices were misconstrued and morphed into something of exoticism and not how they really wanted to represent themselves. And turning over until Assange, I put Samuel by mistake, I'm so sorry. But this is from later in his career. Pretty much it spans from the early part of his career, but also to the later part in the 50s and 60s. And it shows a difference between him and J.A. Green. He's focusing more on the Benin city community in Nigeria. And a lot of the artists that I chose for this project, they were influenced by studio photography, which dealt more with the everyday people, not the elite or foreigners. So these is how Africans want to represent themselves in their best clothing. They have cultural stances. They don't smile a lot sometimes in the early photographs because it's more about showing your full profile. And these two is especially Seydou, Keita. He was very influential to Thandiwe Muriu and also Atong Atem that I showed earlier. So the photographs became more inclusive going on to the 50s, 60s, 70s until today. Now we don't really have photo studios anymore. People have cell phones. Sorry, I'm a little nervous.
You're doing great.
Thank you. So lastly, I have Aïda Muluneh, and I chose this to be my final slide because she sort of bridges the past, the present, and the future, as you can see in that photo of the same sitter on the right. It's broken, but it also is looking towards the future in a way. And it's a beautiful representation of her culture, but she also, like, she's Ethiopian, she likes to incorporate other African cultures just to sort of reclaim the African identity and make it more positive, but also address issues that are facing her community and other African communities today in a more positive light, in a different way than we normally see with just pictures of violence and famine, anything that's negative and bad. She wants to sort of create a positive spin on it, but also say we need to fix these things, but within our own communities. So in conclusion, I would say that all these artists tackle issues of gender inequality and changes to and retention of cultural and traditional practices, as well as environmental degradation and other ways to improve their society on and off the African continent. They show how African women today can initiate change and reform their identities from helpless victims to directors of their own stories. And I also want to thank the ATP for giving me this grant. Well, I know it's a student undergraduate research, and also my advisor, unfortunately, couldn't be here today. My mentor, I mean, she's also my advisor. Dr. Beatrice St. Laurent was really instrumental, and both myself and Catherine was over there. Mm-hmm. So thank you to her if she happens to see this.
Thank you. Oh, my question is, so you had mentioned before how there's not a lot of studio houses. Mm-hmm. Do you think that that impacts the message that artists are trying to send, whether it be positively or negatively?
In a way, so most of this is fine art, so it goes to museums, galleries, and I was discussing with someone earlier about how, so in a way, it's not accessible anymore. So it's pretty much a few people are able to see these images. And in some ways, it's similar to the earlier African photographers, like, you're mostly catering to foreigners at this point. So it's it does change the narrative, because I believe they all also want these images to be shown in their communities to sort of, you know, empower them. But unfortunately, as it stands right now, it's still mostly foreigners that get to look at these images.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, wait, I don't mean to make you repeat yourself, but did you mention that, like, they were forced to be, like, models, or not models, but, like, to be taking pictures?
No. So sometimes they weren't forced per se. Like, they would sit, like, you would have people who would sit for images, and then they were repurposed. So without their consent, the image that they took of them, it was supposed to commemorate special events and stuff like that. But then they would take it, sell it to someone else, and then that would get, circulate, and the meaning would change. So instead of it being something to celebrate a wedding or like a ceremony, like they have a ceremony called Ira, which is prior to a young girl getting married or getting her ready for marriage, that image will turn into like an exotic image of Africa, African people. But they didn't know about that. So the photographer would sell it to someone else, and then it would circulate and have a different meaning.
Oh. Okay, just one more. So within those meetings, was it a lot of negative effects? Because I know, like, certain time periods, people of color weren't being accepted for certain reasons and certain legislations within that. So I was just wondering, when it gets passed around, does it, is there like a lot of like rumors or just lots of
negative? Yeah, so outside of Africa, it was viewed negatively because it was so different from how like Western culture. So it was became examples of like how they are, like some, the words that we use is primitive or savage. Even though in reality, it was just a different way of, you know, celebrating a marriage or even death. They had photos of, you know, someone died, especially a chief. Sometimes, depending on what ethnic group it was, they would take photos of the person who died sitting up. And that got circulating, like, oh, they're, you know, practicing some savage tradition. But in reality, it wasn't like that. It was something positive. They were celebrating the person's life.